everyone. Welcome back to our ArtPath Artist Talks series. My name is Sabrin. I'm a gallery associate at the Lansing Art Gallery. Tonight I'm here with Katrina Daniels and Sarah Parker. The Lansing Art Gallery and Education Center is a nonprofit organization that's been a staple in the Lansing community for over 50 years and has been a leader in the creation of public art in Lansing for over the past 12 years. ArtPath is celebrating its fifth year this year, and it's one of the public art programs that we do. ArtPath is the result of the hard work of Katrina and also Emily Stevens, who is a part of the City of Lansing's Parks and Recreation Department. And then I wanted to say a special thank you to our sponsors, which is Rathburn Insurance and then the Auto Owners Insurance, as well as our site sponsors, Rich Sneary. So I'll hand the microphone over to Hannah Mackey. Thanks so much. Hi. Hi, everyone.
Is that loud?
Great.
Okay, great. Hello. Thank you all so much for being here. This is really exciting. Thank you to Katrina and Sabrin and Sarah and everyone else at the Lansing Art Gallery who made ArtPath possible this year and also who made, you know, this talk today possible. It's just been really, really great to participate in this year's ArtPath, and I'm just really happy to be here. Hi, welcome. I'd also like to thank, before I forget to, everyone at MSU who helped me move and build this piece. It was quite a challenge to move. That includes Walt, Rebecca, Michael, Christy, Manny, and Allison. So thank you to all those people as well. So first, I thought I'd talk about how the piece was made, and let you in on some of those secrets, and then move on to the inspiration for the project and some of the stories there. So in concept, right, this is sort of a very simple sculpture. It's essentially, a 2 foot tall, 4 foot wide cylinder that's covered in tile, right? And simplicity, for me was really necessary because this is only the second time that I've worked with custom tile, right, making it myself. And the form also needed to be strong enough to withstand, up to 4 or 5 people sitting on it all at once. And I knew that even with a shape, sort of as simple as this one, I would be dealing with a lot of, new processes and materials. And I wanted to experiment a bit with those materials without putting the success of the project in jeopardy. So I did a lot of brainstorming, on how to make the structure stable, while still being light enough to move. Some of those ideas included making the piece in several parts to be put together when installed, building the walls of the cylinder, like a tube, and then putting the circle top on it afterwards, like a lid. I also thought about building a sort of hollow structure out of cement. Just went through a lot of different ideas that thankfully I didn't have to actually try out because I went to the wood shop technician at MSU, his name is Walt, and he thought up a much better idea in about 2 minutes, so thank God for him. So what we ended up doing was first building the core of the cylinder out of foam board. So you've probably seen this, if you've been around Home Depot. It's this purple board, that comes in 1 and 2 inch thicknesses. So what I did was I cut those out into the shape of the circle, and then glued them all together so that it basically formed a solid structure to put everything else on top of it. Once that was made, I wrapped the sides of the cylinder in wire mesh and then covered the entire thing in a 1 inch layer of cement. The wire mesh was what helped the cement actually stay up on the sides of the sculpture without just falling down off the edge here. After that, came the tiles, which were adhered to the cement, and then grouted. If you look closely as well, you'll notice that some of the tiles at the very bottom of the sculpture have not been grouted, and that's because those pieces were added after install. to cover up the 8 handholds at the bottom there that allowed us to actually pick up the piece and move it here. So the tiles themselves were also another challenge. In previous work, the tiles that I had made were all square, so you know, they were very easily kind of cut to the same size. You'll see the sides of the sculpture as well also have very similar square-shaped tiles. But the tiles at the top were a lot trickier to make. And that's because the shape of the tiles in each ring is different, right? So there are 16 rings on the surface of this sculpture, so that meant 16 different kinds of tiles needed to be made. And when they were put back on the structure, they needed to be in the right row, otherwise, you know, things wouldn't really fit together well. So to make these, you know, very specific and individual shapes, what I ended up doing was 3D printing a kind of stamp, which I brought here today, so I'll pass those around. And that allowed me to really easily punch the pieces of clay out into that specific shape before moving it to a different sort of slab. And letting them dry out and then eventually firing them. I also, to create the imprints that you see around the tiles here, I did that by laser cutting a piece of acrylic and then gluing that to another piece of acrylic, essentially to make a kind of stamp that I could then push into the wet clay. So you see here, this is a 3D piece, so I'll pass this around if you'd like to look at it. And these are examples of some of the different sort of acrylic stamps that were made to get the designs on the tiles. I've got a few more as well, so I'll pass them. The glaze on the ceramic tiles is also another really interesting part of this process. I originally proposed the sculpture as a purple and bluish color, which, you know, thankfully it did end up coming pretty close to. I tested about 200 glazes with different base recipes and colorants before deciding on one, and eventually, you know, was able to find one that was pretty close to the proposal, which I've got some samples of here today as well. This set of test tiles is a little bit more blue, and it's sort of got a little bit of pink crystal in them. The variation of the value in these glazes is based on the amount of colorant that was added into the glaze. So the more colorant that went in, the darker the glaze became. And when I made the final tiles, I expanded this test set of 5 to a gradient of 10 to get a little bit of a more even variation between the tiles on the final sculpture. Once they were fired, I arranged them sort of from light to dark around the circle in order to kind of create an illusion, you know, that light was hitting it from a certain angle and affecting the value of the tiles that way. And also, you know, because ceramics is so unpredictable, you'll notice that the final tiles look pretty different from the tests. But it is, you know, it's fairly serendipitous that the final tiles actually ended up looking a little bit more like the proposal than the test tiles. So that was very lucky. I'll pass some of these around as well if you'd like to look at them. We've got a set of 5 there. So imagine in my studio, you know, boxes and boxes of these things. filling up, you know, all my space. Those were the gems that ended up decorating my sculpture. So the designs on the top of the sculptures were taken from a drawing that I was planning to use in my thesis work, but later scrapped at the last minute. And so to tell you why these imprints kind of look the way they do, I have to sort of explain how the drawing was made. So I started by sketching digitally on a tablet. The sketch included a lot of sort of tumbling waves, you know, so most of my lines were really fast, repeated curves. And once I had a very loose idea of what that drawing would be, I printed out enlarged sections of that sketch, and then traced and refined those sections with pen and paper. And I got about halfway through this process before stopping. But if I had continued, it would have amounted to about 233 letter-sized pages of drawing. So I already had a lot to work with, you know, having gotten halfway through. And so I took, you know, what I had and sort of moved them to the last step, which was scanning those pages back in to the computer and tracing them using a vector program so that those drawings would essentially become, you know, really clean and resizable vectors. Yeah, so, you know, if you have a vector drawing, for those of you that may not know, it essentially means that, you know, it's a digital rendering of your drawing. You can resize it as you need. And it's also really clear information that you can then send to other machines, like a laser cutter, which is how I ended up getting those different little stamps that are being passed around. So, So, at the end of this drawing process, I had a massive drawing made up of, you know, hundreds of individual little vector shapes. And so when I was coming up with this project proposal, I thought those shapes might work really well on this piece. Because, you know, while they're fairly interesting on their own, they're only legible, you know, when they're sort of put together, when they're part of that overall larger. And so by separating them onto individual tiles and removing a little bit of that legibility, I was I was able to appreciate, you know, those drawings a little bit more, you know, individually, and was able to kind of take away the logic that had sort of produced them and arrange the tiles, you know, with a new kind of logic. Yeah, that way. So the drawings, to me, you know, they look a little bit like symbols. You know, they're definitely kind of hard to read. In some cases, they almost look a little bit like lettering in some way. I think, you know, that contributes a little bit to the sense that they're kind of a puzzle when they're put together. You know, as if you just arranged the rings in a certain way, you know, everything might line up, the sculpture would open, and there'd be some sort of, you know, special hidden treasure inside, instead of, you know, just a bunch of cement and foam board. And so my hope with this was that, you know, because of that sort of potential, you know, that sort of feeling that, you know, if you just stare at it long enough, something will click and you'll be able to figure it out. My hope is that, you know, that sort of prompts returning viewers and then first-time viewers of the work to find, new points of interest in it for them, and, you know, just kind of continually have new experiences with the work, the more time they spend with it. So that's most of, you know, how the sculpture was made. So I'm going to shift topics a little bit here and talk about the inspiration behind the work, and the impetus for applying to ArtPath. Yeah, so in 2018, my family actually came up to East Lansing to see my grandma. One afternoon, we decided to walk along the river and ended up parking, I believe, right next to where The Wheel in the Sky by Christine Beals is now. It may have been a little bit further down the art path, you know, there was something else in that spot, and it was just really surprising and exciting to see, you know, public art in a place that we had never expected. And so when the following year came around and I was applying to grad school and ended up coming to MSU, I learned about the ArtPath through another grad student who was participating in it. And it was, you know, pretty fun to kind of realize that I had unwittingly experienced the very first iteration of ArtPath so many years before. Yeah, so this was a really, really nice moment, you know, even before actually moving to Michigan for school. And also, even though I started grad school in 2019, Last year was actually the very first summer that I was here in Lansing. I had gone home in, I believe, March of 2020 because of the COVID-19 pandemic. So really last summer was the first time I was able to kind of fully experience the art path. And what I would do quite a bit actually was bike from my apartment to this spot in Old Town. And then I'd bike down the art path all the way to the end before biking back towards campus. And so, you know, this became sort of one of my favorite spots in the city. It's just a really, you know, lovely place. You know, there's so much happening, and you've got a fish ladder here and just this beautiful view. And so when it came time to actually, you know, pick a spot for the ArtPath proposal, you know, this was my my first choice. I thought it was, you know, hopefully, you know, a good spot you know, to give people the opportunity to come and sit down and kind of take a break and enjoy the shade here and the scenery. And since this sculpture, you know, essentially a really fancy bench, it kind of felt like a really good move. So another reason I applied to ArtPath was to make something that people could actually interact with directly. I think I mentioned my thesis work earlier, but part of that work was building a 3-by-12-foot pool that was tiled and was shown in the Broad Art Museum from March to May this year. A friend of mine who worked in the museum and gave tours of that MFA show said it was really difficult to stop people from touching that pool. It got to the point where they actually had to put up a sign at the entrance of the gallery that said, "Do not touch the artwork," in all caps. And apparently it was because of that. I don't know, people see tile and they want to touch it, and frankly, I really understand that, you know. You know, when I brought my own family there to visit as well, that was also their first reaction, to lean down and touch it, and of course I couldn't stop them. So a lot of people joked as well about wanting to sit on the pool, wanting to lie down in it. It also seemed to appeal to a lot of the kids that toured the show. I think probably because, you know, it's maybe a little bit more accessible than, you know, a typical gallery is. You know, it's a little bit closer to the ground, so just easier to see and kind of understand what it was. You know, when I was coming up with this project, that audience is really in the back of my mind. Like, you know, people who want to really interact with the work making it accessible to kids as well. I know that, you know, when I was a kid, a lot of the public art that I experienced and that I actually retained memories of were always the ones, you know, that I was able to sit on or climb on in some way. Those, you know, still sort of keep in my mind. So I wanted to make a piece that would service that audience who wanted to engage with the work that I had in the museum, weren't able to at that point in that specific way. There were also quite a lot of differences going into this project in comparison to my thesis, but in concept, I decided to continue some of the same themes that I had been working with before. One of those themes was sort of my personal experience of multiracial identity and cataloging that experience through sculpture and decorative tile. The title of this work, In Memory of a Pond, makes reference to a very specific period of my life. You know, when I spent a lot of time at my great-grandparents' house in Waipahu, Hawaii. And in front of their house, they had a small, empty pond with a miniature pagoda and bridge was made out of cement. And I remember, you know, playing around there and walking across that bridge, which took about one step because, you know, it was like this long, maybe this wide. Just more generally remembering, you know, exploring their garden and the little walkways around their house. Because this all happened when I was fairly young, I can look back on it and sort of understand as an adult, that some of those memories were probably romanticized to some extent. It's difficult to remember, you know, what everything really looked like exactly, where things were placed, etc. And of course, you know, when you remember something, right, when you actually engage in that activity, when you conjure it up in your head, your brain is sort of rewriting that memory each time. And so the more you think about something, or the more you try to remember specific details of an experience, the more likely it becomes that, you know, what you believe about that experience is maybe a little bit exaggerated, or possibly even wrong. Essentially, memory is fickle, right? At the same time, you know, recalling these experiences is a really important part of building an identity. The memories that I have, you know, of my great-grandparents and at their house, is an important part of who I am. And that idea of having to build an identity based on things that may or may not be true is sort of what influenced how I distributed the imprints on the top of this sculpture. So as you move from the center of the circle outwards, things sort of get exponentially more complicated, right? There's, more details and colors and relationships to explore. And to me, this kind of, this sort of codex of symbols and expanding rings is sort of a visual reminder of, you know, what it can feel like to parse through your own memories. You may be trying to get back to like the one true version of events, the center of the circle, but compounding experiences and just the act of trying to remember is sort of going to get in your way every time. So to me, it's important to find a way to kind of be okay with that, and to, you know, allow myself to grow and change in ways that might not always be totally comprehensible, but I think, you know, are always sort of for the better. Also, you know, sort of managing a little bit of this, existential turmoil is a little bit easier when you're in a spot like this one. You sit down and just enjoy the view. It was also really special, you know, after this piece had been completed and installed, to share photos of this work with my family back home in Hawaii, and actually talk about them, you know, about my great-grandparents. All of our time there. And when I showed my auntie this sculpture, she told me about my great-grandpa's work building rock walls around the island. That was actually his job. It was another feature of their home as well. The rock walls that he built with sort of a chain-link gate in the middle. To this day, my auntie said that, you know, you can tell the walls that he built apart from others, because, you know, while many people would sort of flatten the top of their rock walls by putting cement over it, he would actually, you know, pick very specific rock that leveled out the entire top of it evenly. It's a little difficult to imagine, you know, what he might have said about some of the tiles poking up about here, but, you know, still learning. Hopefully, you know, one day they'll be as sort of flat and precise as the work that he did. It was also, you know, working on this, just a really lovely opportunity to think about, you know, them and sort of how they shape me as a person. I'm actually named after my great-grandma, one of the very short and clear memories that I have of her is her sitting on the couch with a bowl of ice cream and spoon-feeding our tiny little dog from her spoon, which is a little gross, but it is very sweet. I also learned, you know, so much about building this kind of sculpture, making something to be displayed outdoors, you know, durable enough, visually resting enough to, have sort of a presence in this space. I hope in the future there'll be other opportunities to make similar things like this and keep improving and keep learning. In any case, you know, participating in this year's ArtPath has been just really fantastic and a great learning opportunity. So thank you again to everyone at the Lansing Art Gallery and to all of you here today. That's everything that I had prepared to say about this sculpture. So thank you again.
Thank you.
many hours of work does this sculpture represent? Kind of scares me to count a little bit. Like, it was quite a while. Let's see. I think I probably worked on it for a month straight, like a typical work day. It was, I think when it got accepted, I had already tested a lot of the glazes that I wanted to use, so I kind of had an idea of, you know, which ones specifically. And then after that, I just went straight into, you know, making, I think what became about 2,000 tiles to go on here, and also, you know, getting all of the stamps printed and things like that. So it's like a solid month. Getting all of that done. Yeah, and then a lot of people helped me as well keep me well informed about how to do something like this. Yes, definitely.
Yes. So, Susie, we talked about your colleagues that, you know, helped you formulate the carving. Again, so what other type of work do you guys tile work?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I do 2D and 3D. Sorry, I should probably give you a break. I came to the MFA program as a graphic designer, actually. And I worked that way for 2 years. So the first 2 years of the program, I was mainly working digitally, doing prints and whatnot. And then this summer, I think last March or May, when I came back here, I immediately started working in ceramics, so it's really like a crash course. Thankfully, you know, the staff was around to help me out, but they taught me, you know, basically everything in that summer, and then I was able to just sort of run with it, and made ceramics my entire thesis work, and then as soon as I graduated, basically started on this. So it's been really great. Originally it was, pretty much all 2D.
So what was the impetus for you transitioning from graphic design, which is so digital, but also just like the absolute opposite of working in like the 3D space? What was the impetus behind that?
Thanks. What was it? It was, I think it was because actually I was working in a lot of, I was making a lot of digital patterns, and I really wanted a way to just, you know, be able to put those on 3D forms in a way that wasn't, so clearly translated from the digital. Maybe at that point I wasn't being too creative, but I just thought of ceramics, and I was like, oh, yeah, that'll work. Let's just dive headfirst into this brand new medium. But I think it translated really well. Like, For part of my thesis work, what I did was, I had sort of these kind of intricate drawings, and then I carved into plaster, to make those drawings sort of into a really soft sculpture in a way, and then sort of pressed that into a clay slab. And so, you know, the drawing showed up, but it was also, you know, it sort of had some sort of 3D form to it. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, relief tile. Thank you. But yeah, so I think it felt pretty natural at first, and tile was definitely a medium that I just, you know, had always sort of wanted to explore, and the exhaustion of having to make so many tiles. I don't know. At some point, it kind of feels nice, right? Like you're really sort of pouring everything that you have into, you know, making a work, right? Just because you need, you know, so much time and then so many different pieces to complete something.
I think that's in the history of the Byzantine Empire, a lot of tile type work was done as part of their art. They wanted, instead of drawing a person with paint or with ink and paints, they would do something like this and either glue it onto a flat surface. And I was just wondering if you ever looked into that, or if it was that inspired you at all, or if you've seen any work like that, that goes back a long time, 1,000 years, but I mean, that's kind of, some artists did the work before painting, and then or Rembrandt started with his way of painting. It kind of reminds me of it, but I just wondered if you had any thoughts on that type of history.
Yeah, thank you. I don't know that I have a whole lot of sort of back catalog of that particular kind of reference, but I've definitely, you know, gotten to, you know, visit some museums and definitely look through a little bit of the road catalog for inspiration. I do really like the low relief tiles. I've seen some, like, really deep ones that are, maybe would have been a little bit too much to do. In a month's time, but yeah, hopefully in the future, that would be fantastic.
I was just asking, are you using like a stoneware or a porcelain? What type of clay are you using?
Porcelain. Yeah. I think you can probably see a little bit of it on the side that's maybe peeking out from under the grout. But yeah, it's a very kind of pure looking white that I've been making everything out of.
Does it have a name?
What
is it? I'm sorry, I missed it.
It's in memory of a pond.
Oh, in memory of a pond.
Yeah. Afterwards.
You said something earlier about it's only going to be here until September.
Yes.
Have you found a permanent home, or are you looking for one?
I am looking for one. Yeah. If anyone, you know, anyone who wants to help me move this out of here, you know, if they can give it a permanent home, I am all for that.
Why only until September?
That's when the art path ends. Yeah. I mean, it gets a little bit desolate.
I can talk to you about finding a permanent home.
We can help make that happen.
Yeah.
Well, I hope you guys do make it happen.
Yeah.
That's a beautiful piece.
I have a question. I'm sorry if you mentioned this before, but you mentioned your interest in pattern and, like, you started out doing graphic design and then moved to ceramics. And why tile specifically? Is it because tile often is used to create patterns, or like what drew you to tile rather than a different form of ceramic?
Yeah. Thanks for that question. I think it's exactly what you said.
Yeah.
That tile translated so well to pattern, and also it sort of served, you know, as I was starting out, as kind of a safety net, right, for someone who really didn't have any experience in ceramics beforehand. You know, you can make 2,000 tiles, and if half of them turn bad, you've still got quite a lot of them. You can still make something out of it. I haven't counted. I can't really tell you how many tiles left over I had. But, I think it's a really great medium for me, at least, you know, in starting out to work with.
Reminds me of like playground equipment. I mean, there's a lot of playgrounds around the country now that they're really getting creative with their plastic, designing plastic everything that you spend time on. There's room for an artist in that. I mean, to help people that can. Right? Is there any room for ceramics in that kind of thing? Or is that too delicate of a thing for kids to play as? I mean, you know, like, I don't know.
I mean, that would be fantastic, right? I kind of made it this size and this height so that it would be really easily accessible. I'm definitely jealous of kids now because you get like those amazing playgrounds. just, you know.
I never had that when I was a kid.
Right? They've got rock walls and everything now. Oh my god, but. Yeah.
That's another scary part. Maybe there's something out there.
This ArtPath is one of the impetus behind ArtPath is making art more accessible, right? And like breaking down those barriers of like this white cube gallery that can be so intimidating. So then when you made something that you intentionally wanted people to interact with, I think that's like at the heart of what we wanted this public art project to be. You know, something that like someone that can come upon this and experience it, but they also can touch it and sit on it, and it doesn't have that, you know, when you're in a museum, everything is so protected, you know, and it can be kind of intimidating for folks who maybe aren't as like involved in the art world. So I love that. And I hope everybody takes a chance to sit on it.
He's
taking it home today and I think there's something. Yeah.
Does anyone else have any other questions?
No, one more. Do you have some kind of a deadline, a timeline, to you making this and looking at them at some point?
I don't remember the exact date when it started, but I believe I was on the very last day to install for the ArtPath. I was also late, unfortunately. Just because it was so heavy. You know, like I did not expect it to be that heavy. And when four of us lifted it just to see, you know, how much it weighed, we put it down, and suddenly everyone around me started calling their friends and you know, spouses, like, please come help us move this thing.
How much does it weigh?
I'm guessing it must weigh at least 400 pounds. I was expecting it to be about 3, but I don't think I calculated well enough the weight of the tile and the tile adhesive. Yeah, because that was quite a feat.
I just wanted to thank everybody for coming out tonight for our talk with Hannah. And as a reminder, for next week we have a reception for our new exhibition for Trevor Grable. It's going to be on the 14th at 5 p.m. And then on the 28th, we have two artist talks. We have Jessica Coban, which is our brown bag artist talk, which is going to be at noon. And then we'll also have another ArtPath artist talk, which will be Joan Cranberry, and that will be at 6 p.m. at her site. So thank you so much for coming out tonight.